The name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. So last time we spoke about, and it was 2 Peter chapter 2, and we stopped right in the middle of that chapter. And the last chapter, just to kind of remind you of some of the things that it talked about, it's talking to us about the deception of the false teachers, and how, you know, that there is going to be a price for that deception when someone part of the body takes someone away from the body of the church. There is going to be a price for that. And he says that God, that does the destruction of these people, it will come, for sure will come. And God has patience on them, but the destruction will end up happening. So today we're going to continue. And he spoke about the angels. The angels were, there were destruction. The angel, when they rebelled against God, they did fall. At the time of Noah, people during Noah's time, also after he built the ark for 120 years, there was destruction for those who did not accept the call and the preaching of righteousness that Noah did, and they were flooded. And so the one thing that was common is that there is salvation for the faithful and destruction for the unfaithful. That's the theme. And then today he's going to talk to us, when we continue the chapter, about the depravity of these false teachers. How low a person can actually get and to try to deceive people from the church. So in verse 10, it's second Peter chapter 2, verse 10. Okay. So we start out and it says, "And especially those who walk according to the flesh, in the lust of uncleanness and despise authority." Here he's talking about the false teachers as being walking according to the flesh. One of the things that the false teachers seek is besides greed and monetary things, but also fame. So one of the things is that when you look at, sometimes people run after preachers when there's a lot of people following him, but you want to be careful, because sometimes people look at after the fame. And he's saying, especially those who walk according to the flesh in the lust of uncleanness and despise authority. Also, these false teachers that bring up heresies or different teaching in the church despise authority. What is despise authority? Despise authority in the sense they cannot accept someone above them. They cannot accept that. And a lot of times we see that in children. Children despise the authority of their parents. And this is something that we are to be careful of. And here we see these false teachers, they despise the authority. They cannot stand someone to have an authority over them. But the important thing is that when the authority issue is a bigger issue than that, is that if we despise the authority that we see, for instance, if I despise my father and my mother, or if I despise my boss at work or anything like that, any authority, if I despise the authority that I see, how am I going to respect and honor the ultimate authority of the Lord that I do not see? I feel, but I do not see. So here, one of the signs of these false teachers is they despise authority. Then it goes on, it says they are presumptuous, self-willed. So in other words, they're very strong-willed. They cannot accept, and they're also arrogant. There's a lot of arrogance in them. When it comes to these false teachers, you'll find that they're very arrogant. Not anyone can speak to them in any way, and very arrogant and self-willed. In other words, strong-willed in whatever they're doing, and they don't listen to any authority. And one of the things that works a lot in the monastic life is this issue here, respecting authority, respecting those who are above you. And you hear a lot of stories in fathers and you see these abbots of the monastery telling the monk to do something that is really, really hard. But because he respects authority, he does it. And you hear the story that this abbot of the monastery told the monk told him, you know, "Abbot, I've been reading the Bible for a long time and I don't retain much." So he told him, "Okay, let's put the Bible aside. I want you to take this basket and go and fill it up with water." So the monk has to be obedient. So he has to do what the abbot of the monastery tells him. So he takes the basket and he goes, he puts it in under, he dives, puts it under the water. And guess what happens? The water all seeps out of the basket. He does it all day, and then he goes back and he says, you know, abbot, I've been trying all day to do this. And because I need to be, respecting the authority and listen to what you're telling me, but I couldn't do it. But the message that he was telling him, that it's, yes, it cleaned the basket. When you did that, it cleaned the basket. The same thing the Bible does. But here, ultimately, is that respecting authority. Even sometimes when it didn't make sense, I knew the basket. But there is respect of authority. Here, the false teachers, they despise authority. So they are presumptuous, self-willed. And not only that, but they are also stubborn. When you read on, it says they are not afraid to speak evil of dignitaries. In other words, not just despise the authority, but they also speak evil against them. Like, for instance, when somebody says something bad about the Pope or authority. So not only that they cannot accept authority, but they speak evil against them. And this is one of the signs of false teachers. They are not afraid to speak evil of dignitaries. And then he gives an example that even the angels, and we read that in the book of Jude, cannot say something bad about someone else. It says that whereas angels who are greater, I'm sure the angels are greater than any of the false teachers. The angels, he's saying, even the angels who are greater in power and might do not bring a reviling accusation against them before the Lord. And we see that in the book of Jude, where he gave us also the example that when angels fell and became devils, the angels would not even say something against these fallen angels, but they said, go and God rebuke you. So even in that case, they don't say something evil against, even the angels are not able to speak bad against the fallen angels, or here in the case, speaking evil of dignitaries, somebody that is authority. Okay? Whereas angels who are greater in power and might do not bring a reviling accusation against them. Against them, the meaning the authorities, okay, the authorities that we're talking about before the Lord. Verse 12, it goes on, it says, but these, he's talking about the false teachers, they are like natural brute. In other words, he's assimilating them to animals. They are like natural brutes, beasts, made to be caught and destroyed. He's going back to the example that yes, there will be destruction to false teachers. They are like animals that will be destroyed at the end. They speak evil of all things. They do not understand and will utterly perish in their own corruption. In other words, these false teachers are walking to their own destruction. In verse 13, it says, they will receive the wages of unrighteousness. And this is the price of unrighteousness, price of rebellion. There is always going to be a price for rebellion, and we'll talk more about it tomorrow, because tomorrow is going to be the prodigal son, where he rebelled against his father. And there's always a destruction, and here we see it the same thing. And they will receive the wages of unrighteousness as those who count it pleasure to carouse in the daytime. In other words, they're not afraid to be in front of everybody and do these evil deeds and speak bad about dignitaries and also bring heresies in the church. And then he moves up, by the way, the rest of the chapter, he's going to be talking about these false teachers and describing them in many things. So that's what we can expect the rest of this chapter. And then he's also describing them as they are spots. They are spots and blemishes carousing in their own deception while they feast with you. In other words, he's saying that, like, for instance, the body of the church, they are like spots. The bride of the of Christ, the church, the false teachers in the middle, they are like spots, like a stain. And here he's saying that there will be like spots and blemishes, carousing in their own deception, bringing all the bad heresies in the church, and then they feast with you. And the word feast with you is that sometimes these false teachers, they become part of the church and so on, but they also feast with you. In other words, they take communion with you, but really inside they're false teachers. Having eyes full of adultery and that cannot cease from sin, enticing unstable souls. And here they're talking about these false teachers are driven by their flesh. Their eyes is full of adultery. And not only that, but they can't stop from these heresies and sinning, enticing unstable souls. In other words, when somebody comes up with a wrong idea in the church, they try to entice other people in the body. And enticing people that are still young in the faith, and they start changing their minds to this heresy of theirs, the false teachers of the teaching of that they believe in. So here they entice the rest of some of the body of the church, that the unstable souls. And then he goes on and he says they have a heart trained in covetous practice. So they exploit, they covet. That's how they do things. They're always coveting, and are accursed children. Verse 15, it says, they have forsaken the right way and gone astray, following the way of Balaam, the son of Beor, who loved the wages of unrighteousness. But he was rebuked for his iniquity. A dumb donkey, speaking with a man's voice, restrained the madness of the prophet. And here he's giving an example, comparing the false teachers in the church to one of the prophets in the Old Testament, Balaam. So what's the story of this Balaam that he's comparing to? So one of the things you read about this story of Balaam in Numbers 22. Balaam was a prophet. He was a prophet that did God's work and so on. But one day, the king of Moab came to Balaam and told him, I want you to curse the people, God's people, because they came against our land and we don't want them to be next to us, and we want to invade them, and I know that God hears you. What I want you to do, I want you to curse God's people. And they enticed him with money. But for God's man, God's prophet to do that, that's not acceptable. So what happens is Balaam, every time he desires to curse the people of Israel, he can't. So one of the things that he did, he gave them an idea. He told them, okay, you Moabites, one of the ways you can do to invade the God's people, the Israelites, take some of your daughters and let them entice the men of the Israelites, of the Jewish nation, and when they commit sin against them, they will stray away from God and you are able to invade them. So here Balaam gave this bad idea that to overcome God's people to this Moabite king. One of the things that happened is that in the process, he was told to come so he can go and curse the people. So he rode on his donkey. As he's riding on his donkey, all of a sudden, because God was not in favor of what this prophet was doing, an angel came in front of the donkey. And the donkey was trying to move, but he sees an angel with a sword and he can't move. Balaam was really upset with his donkey. He hit it 3 times. And then after 3 times, all what he heard is that he heard the donkey speak to him and told him, what is it that I've done to you? And all of a sudden he realized that we was not able to hear God, but a donkey from a man's voice, he heard and he woke him up. He says, what are you doing, Balaam? And this is the story in Numbers 22. And you hear, you read, you know, where the donkey stopped and he said, what I have done to you that you struck me this third time. And all of a sudden it says, Balaam then said to the donkey, because you abused me, I wish there were a sword in my hand, for now I would kill you. And then later than that, he realized that Balaam was doing a mistake by going and wanting to curse God's people. And here he's telling him that, by the way, the reason Balaam did that was for money, for goods, for greed. It was greed that drove Balaam, the prophet of God, to do something such sinful, to give an idea on how to, you know, for people to overcome the Israelites. So here, the same thing with these false prophets. Here, St. Peter is comparing Balaam, the prophet, who out of greed wanted to sell God's people, and also the false teachers that also sometimes in the body would actually do the same thing. They were out of greed, they would bring these heresies in the church and so on. And then in verse 17, it says, these are wells without water. So in other words, they promise you some things and they don't fulfill it. When you walk up to a well, what do you expect? You expect water. Here he's saying that these people, these false teachers, are wells without water. They promise you something, but they don't deliver. So wells without water. Another example, he says that they are clouds carried by a tempest. What does the cloud promises us? When there is cloud over LA, what is the promise? Most likely, there is going to be rain. But here he's saying these people, they promise you they're clouds, they're like water, but the tempest comes and there's no water. So in other words, false promises. And then he goes on, it says, for whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever? And he's saying the result of these false teachers and the way they bring heresies in the church is blackness and darkness forever. Verse 18, he says, for when they speak great swelling words of emptiness, they allure through the lusts of the flesh, through lewdness, the ones who have actually escaped. And here he's telling them that these false prophets, their words are swelling words, but they're empty. They're swelling, but they're empty. There's nothing to them. And they're walking through the lusts of the flesh, through lewdness. Lewdness is sexual immorality, by the way. And then it says that the one who have actually escaped. And here what he's talking about, allure, meaning they try to bring the people that are part of the body of Christ, allure them away by giving them false ideas, alluring them in lusts of the flesh. In other words, when there is someone that starts teaching, whatever it feels good, do it. Lust of the flesh. And this is happening today in the world. It seems like whatever the flesh desires, you are to give it. And that's not against that's against what God's have taught, what God have taught us, is that we are to restrain that body. And here, this is some of these teachings that they start bringing in the church, is that they allured people by the lusts of the flesh and teaching bad teaching, as what's going on today in the world, in the society that we live in. If it's something that you cannot restrain, then it's okay, do it. And not only do it, but what about if we make it even legal? And this is, think about it. So instead of restraining and dealing with the flesh, let's continue doing it, but let's also make it legal. And you see that through the history of the U.S. And I'm not talking about the history of Egypt. The history of the U.S., a lot of things were illegal, but the men cannot restrain themselves, and it was overturned and now becomes legal. 1920, alcoholism, alcohol. That was not able to be sold before 1920. Now it's being sold. There's a lot of things. Marijuana. This was illegal. Now it's becoming, I have a small license that the doctor gave me, and now it's legal. And there is a lot of studies that it shows that it messes up the brain, but now it's becoming legal. Drugs and same gender marriage, all these things at one point in the United States were illegal. Not just not frowned of, illegal. There was 1980s. In 1980, there was anti-sodomy laws in the U.S. But now it's overturned, and it's actually legal. The same judge. So be thinking of that. And these ideas, this is what these false teachers at one point, and could be false teaching in the church. Yes, it's okay. Let's do it. Let's fulfill the lust of the flesh. Through lewdness, the ones who have actually escaped from those who live in error. And then in verse 19, it says, well, they promised them liberty. In other words, and this is what's happening today. What's happening today is that a lot of the things that is being told, you are in a free land, liberty. But they practice the wrong meaning of liberty. Liberty to do whatever I desire, that's not right. Liberty, the true meaning of liberty is freeing my body from the vices, the things that put me under a vice. Okay? While they promised them liberty, they themselves are slaves of corruptions. So here they are enslaved to this sin, these false teachers, and they try to the other people to practice the same things that they practice. Okay? Are slaves of corruption. For by whom a person is overcome, by him also he is brought into bondage. And he's saying that this lewdness and these immoral things, it enslaves us. It brings us to bondage. In verse 20 it says, For if after they have escaped the pollution of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the latter end is worse for them than the beginning. And here he's talking about these false teachers. Before they become false teachers, they were people from the world. And they believed and they accepted Christ. But now what happened is that then after accepting Christ and being part of the body and feasting with us, they go back to their old ways, to their old sins that they did prior to being part of the body of Christ. It says, for if after they have escaped, they're just talking about their prior life, after they escaped the pollutions of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, so they escaped the world because they were non-believers, and then now they became part of the body of Christ, and then they are again entangled in them and overcome. The latter end is worse for them than the beginning. And he's saying that then they end up being much worse off than they were before, because they go back to their old ways. And he's going to give two examples of animals that do the same thing. Dogs. When you find dogs, when a dog vomits, he walks away, and the dog will come back later to his vomit and eat it. And that's how he's going to close. So this is the same example. He's saying that these people were away from God, then they accepted, but then they went back to their old habits. And when they go back, it's usually much worse than it was before. Verse 21, it says, for it would have been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness, than having known it, to turn from their holy commandment delivered to them. So here, it would have been better for them to just stay non-believers, then come and then go back to their old ways. And then in the last verse, he says, but it has happened to them, according to the true proverb. And now he's going to quote from the book of Proverbs. A dog returns to his own vomit. And this, we see that. You see that whenever you have a dog. I had a dog when I was growing up. And it's very weird. It's a very weird phenomenon. But sometimes you see him doing that. And here he's giving an example. He's assimilating these false teachers to dogs that going back to their vomit. And then he closes also, and a sow having washed to her wallowing in the mire. And a sow, by the way, is a pig. S-O-W. It means a pig. Is that how it's saying in there? Yeah, same thing. A sow having washed to her wallowing in the mire. You take a pig and you wash him, he cannot stand it. He will have to go back in the dust and the dirt and make himself dirty again. And he's giving an example. So these false teachers, these false prophets that may arise with heresies in the church are similar to these two examples, where a dog returns to his own vomit, or a pig that you try to take and you wash, and what does he do? He ends up going back, wallowing in his mire. So this is the end of the chapter. We'll start the third chapter next week. But I encourage you, it's the last chapter, by the way, of that second letter of St. Peter. So we'll finish that chapter next week. Any questions? Any questions? And I encourage questions. And I encourage, if you have a question in the middle of the talk, I don't have a problem, you know, raise your hand, and we would like to clear things as we're going along. I encourage you to read it again. It's good that we are opening our eyes, because throughout the church history, there were false prophets, and there were false prophets from our own, and these are the ones that caused divisions. You know, people from the body of the church, they come up with a heresy. You see Arius a long list of people. And here he's telling us that this will continue. Just make sure that we are understanding, and be careful of false prophets. And ultimately, respect also authority. Respect authority. Whether it's your authority in your household, authority in the church, authority and there's some things that have been going on even in the Coptic Orthodox Church, and you see those who are they come up with something else, they respect, they go to they discuss it with the Pope and they reason things and they respecting authority is very important. And all the glory be to our God forever. Amen. Let us stand up to pray. Make us worthy, O Lord, to pray. Thankfully, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses. We forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from the evil one. Through Christ Jesus our Lord, thine is the kingdom, power, glory forever. Amen. Now the love of God the Father, the grace of his only begotten Son, our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, the communion and gift of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Go in peace. The peace of the Lord be with you.